You are interested in the unusual, the mysterious, the unexplainable. That is why you are here.
It's the Opperman Report. Join digital forensic investigator and PI Ed Opperman for an in-depth discussion of conspiracy theories, strategy of New World Order resistance, high-profile court cases in the news, and interviews with expert guests and authors on these topics and more. It's the Opperman Report. And now, here is investigator Ed Opperman.
Okay, welcome to the Opperman Report. I'm your host, private investigator Ed Opperman, and this show is brought to you by the loving support of our sponsors like cart-king.com, 877-986-7771. If you want to go into the mobile cart or kiosk business, cart-king.com, the guys you want to need there, they've been in business 20 years. Go to their website, cart-king.com, and you can pick out the design that applies to your business. You want to sell coffee, food, flowers, souvenirs, cart-king.com. You go to the website, you pick out the design, they'll custom design it for you, custom build it for you, ship it worldwide. And you got almightygold.com. You can invest in gold. Why invest in paper when you can invest in gold, something that's going to appreciate? That makes no sense. Of course you want to invest in gold. Everybody does. Everybody who listens to the Opperman Report wants to invest in gold. Almightygold.com, you can start investing in gold for as little as $5, $6, $10. You don't have to spend $1,000 on a gold coin or a gold Krugerrand. Get a carat bar. It's embedded into a little plastic credit card-sized card, and it's in little $10, $20 increments. Almightygold.com. You can get into the gold business yourself and sell these little carat bars. They drop ship it for you. All you have to do is put up a little link on your Facebook page, your Twitter account, your website, your blog, and you get a commission for every piece of gold that's sold. I also have a cryptocurrency that's backed by gold, Pure Soap Flake Company. Pure Soap Flake Company is puresoapflakes.com. You can find them at greenhome.com, amazon.com. You can find them at Whole Foods, 218-568-2525. You can bathe your body, clean your products in this clean, organic soap. It's safe for drains, waterways, great and high-efficiency washers and top front-loading machines. Bathe your body, wash your clothes with Pure Soap products that are free of fragrance, GMOs, palm oil, sodium lauryl sulfate, and synthetic additives. And they say, well, Ed, what's wrong with palm oil? Well, when you use up the palm oil in soap and cream and makeup, the orangutans got no palm to eat. This is what they live on. They live on the palm, so the orangutans are starving. So buy this stuff, the orangutans get to eat. There you go. Emailrevealer.com, adoption investigations, infidelity investigations, email tracing, asset searches, locate. So want to locate long-lost loved one, go to emailrevealer.com. I'll find them for you. Okay, our first guest today is Ken Ammi, and he's written this book here, 50 Shades of Grey, Aliens. In consideration of aliens, UFOs, abductees, contactees, experiences, channeling, and more. You can find his website at True Free Thinkers. Is that True Free Thinker or Thinkers.com?
Singular, Thinker.
Thinker. TrueFreeThinker.com. Mr. Ammi, are you there?
I am. Thanks for having me on, Ed.
No, thank you so much. Tell us about yourself. Who is Ken Ammi? I detect an Israeli accent.
No. Let me just say first, I feel like I should say something like, long-time listener, first-time caller.
Yeah.
Because I have been a fan of yours for a long time, and when you brought my buddy William Ramsey on board, that was just icing on the cake for me.
Yeah, I met him early on. Yeah, I met William. I did my first show was on the West Memphis 3, and he contacted me right away. And I says, you know, so, man, he blew me away. We did that first show was about West Memphis 3, then his work on the 9/11 was just, you know, I tell you,
right.
Terrifying stuff. Yeah. So where is your accent from? Where, it's not Israeli?
No, I am Argentinian.
Get out of here. Okay, I always thought I was pretty good about that. Okay. So, no, really, I think I have a good ear for accents, you know, especially coming from New York. I've known a lot of Israeli people. I never would have guessed Argentinian. Now, so tell us about yourself. Who is Ken Ammi?
Yes, who is Ken Ammi? Well, I was born at a young age, so that's important to know. And Actually, I started life as a child. So, you know, that's definitely something unique, I think.
Those are really good lines. I like those. I'm going to steal that from you, man. I like both of those, man.
Well, yeah, having been born in a foreign country, moving to the States, and having lived in three different cities and everything, I've been, you know, been around a bit, met all kinds of people and have various interests. So I consider myself a researcher. And my wife laughs at me because I tell my kids, you know, in my day, looking something up meant that I would get on my bicycle, ride quite a few blocks to the library, pull out the little drawers with the index cards and look up books and do that kind of stuff. So she says, oh, yeah, and did you do it in the snow backwards? Yeah, for a nickel.
Yeah, but let me tell you something. I grew up the same way, and hanging out at the library, you know, New York City. We had great libraries there. You know, I really appreciate it now living out here in Nevada. The New York public library system was a gold mine of information. But what do you do for a living? What is your background? What do you do?
Well, let me just – the reason I was mentioning that is because it was at the library that I would – especially I remember when I was 11, I was very much into reading up on cryptozoology and witchcraft and UFOs and all the weird kind of paranormal fringe stuff. That's what I was really into back then. So I love going to the library and just diving into all those books about weird stuff like that. So that's not really to say I've kept up with the field of aliens and UFOs ever since then, but that's how long ago I had an interest in it. Of course, in a way, not much has really changed. I mean, sure, today we might have a lot more photographs and videos, but in a way, nothing's changed because you have a number of supposed sightings that are explainable, but you always end up with that minority of truly unexplained phenomena, and that's always been the same, like I said.
You know, also, too, something that's different now, too, is we have this this History Channel. They call it the History Channel.
Yes.
But, you know, there's never any history on there anymore, and it's like 24/7 ancient aliens.
Right.
Being brought to us, sold to us by Rupert Murdoch owns that station, people should realize. I'm sure he's doing us a lot of favors in what he wants to teach. It's a secret information. With some of these characters you see on there, like Sean David Morton, who's in prison today. But back in our youth, you know, I'm 56 years old. Those books, Eric von Daniken and Chariots of the Gods, that was big stuff, man. It was chills, gave you chills watching that stuff.
It was, and now that's becoming very much part of our cultural zeitgeist is this ancient aliens idea, which came from Van Doniken's concept of the ancient astronauts. And it is really, bottom line, it is replacing God with an alien savior, and it is part of what's really, really important about the messages that alleged aliens are giving to us today. In fact, let me plug something ahead of time. I just finished writing a book, which is a worldview-based review of the movies, the franchises, Aliens and Predator. And both of those franchises, which of course had crossover movies, they are very much moved into that direction of the ancient aliens. Of aliens have been visiting us for millennia. We used to worship them as gods. They left their mark all over the planet. That's very common nowadays.
Oh, yeah. It seems to be that they're really pushing it. Because what other channel do they have devoted to that kind of information 24/7?
Go ahead.
Yeah, the book, okay, 50 Shades of Grey Aliens, okay. What are we going to find in here?
Well, the way I like to describe it is that as an author it's almost subconscious sometimes where you go out to – you decide to write a book and you determine your parameters, right? What am I going to write about? Where am I going to start? Where am I going to stop? So that way your book is containing certain set of ideas and you know where to stop. That's always important, or else you just end up making it so abstract it's difficult to read. But in this case, instead of, say, taking a rifle approach and shooting it one nice little clean bullet, I kind of decided to take a shotgun approach, and I went in various directions at once. So part of it deals with some of the key players in these movements, like Whitley Strieber or Travis Walton and Billy Meyer. Part of it deals with the actual claims. What are the claims? What are the actual phenomena? There's even a chapter on whether there's aliens and UFOs in the Bible. There's stuff about something that is inescapable, inevitably, when you're dealing with these issues, which is the occult. And so I kind of went in various directions, and I think it makes it an interesting book, because if you want to read it cover to cover, do so. And if not, it's more like a reference where you can just kind of pick whatever suits your fancy on any given day and go to that. And part of it includes the reason I call it 50 Shades of Grey Alien. It's for two reasons, obviously, is to play off of that book, the 50 Shades of Grey book. But part of it was because of all the different alleged aliens that have been reported, the Greys, as they're known, have definitely become the poster child. And I kind of went into trying to figure out where that stereotypical appearance of aliens came from.
Oh, that's interesting. And what did you find?
Well, so just a little bit of background is I already mentioned ancient aliens and crossing over into movies. And, well, why do we have this fascination about fiction? And we recognize that a lot of it is actually propagandized, right? So our culture doesn't sit around campfires and hear about great stories of myth and legend and philosophy and ethics, right? We sit around the flickering light of TV screens and movies, and that's where we get our myth, our legend, our philosophy, our ethics, right? So we're very much an entertainment-based culture, and we can't just say it's a movie, therefore it's not relevant to real life, because people are writing some of their world views, their real life world views, into their fiction. Okay, so that's just a background into where I'm going with this, which is that I started thinking about just that. So where did this typical large head, large eyes, essentially no ears or nose, little mouth, shriveled up little body, where'd that come from? Because it's become so very popular, like I said, the stereotype, the poster boy. Well, and when I began my research on that, the very first thing I looked at was my conclusion, because I looked at an essay written by H.G. Wells in the late 1800s called The Man of the Year Million. And there he is thinking about, well, what will human beings look like a million years from now, you know, in the year million? And, well, guess what? They have very large heads, very large eyes, little tiny noses and ears, little shriveled up bodies. So there you go. I was done already. And so his reasoning was, obviously, that our mental capacities would increase, along which, for some reason, he thought the brain would expand, which would require an expansion of the cranium, along which would come the enlarged eyes. And then we wouldn't need much in terms of a mouth, because we would get our nutrition from basically wading in hot tub-like devices where we would absorb nutrients, and our bodies would just be a little shriveled up, diminutive, because we would have machinery like high tech to do all the physical labor for us. Okay, so then I traced this concept forwards in time through the golden era of sci-fi and comic books and all that. And guess what? Well, they're constantly imagining human beings visiting us from the future. And what do they look like? Well, they look like that exactly. And then eventually I kind of figure, well, how many different ways can you tell the same story? So eventually what the sci-fi author started doing is they said, hey, guess what? Those beings, the ones with the big heads and little bodies and everything, they're not actual human beings from the future. Guess what? They're aliens. And there you had the crossover. And so today you have that image as that of the alien, wherever they may come from. But it originally derived from people trying to speculate as to what human beings would look like. And that's actually a speculation that has been ongoing. As recently as last month, a professor, I don't recall his name off the top of my head, but there's still people saying that's what they think aliens are. They're not actual biological entities from another planet. They're just human beings visiting us from the future, and that's what they look like.
Now, what do you think it is, though, that causes people to, you know, because especially the abduction phenomenon, especially in the late 90s, like everyone thought they was being abducted. It was on TV constantly. And they would picture these little gray aliens.
Right.
What causes that kind of thing? They implant this in the movies and the TV shows and put it in our heads?
Well, part of my real concern is that I don't think that there will ever be an aliens and UFOs theory of everything. That is to say, I think it's such a vast, complicated, and abstract set of phenomena that no one thing will ever explain all of it. We're going to need an overarching theory of everything in order to explain it all. So if you don't mind, I'll kind of answer that by going in a roundabout way, which is that the minute we say something like, hey, let's talk about aliens and UFOs, well, we've already created a gigantic mess, because there are people who claim to have seen UFOs but don't have an experience with aliens, and there's people who have claimed to have experience with aliens but never see a UFO. So that alone makes these two different categories. So if we mash them together, that creates a lot of problems. But there are people who have claimed to see UFOs and had experiences with aliens, so there you go. Now you have a merging of the two, so that's a third category. Okay, and then you need to think about, well, what do we mean by UFOs? And obviously, the literal term is unidentified flying objects. So I've seen UFOs. I've seen something in the sky and been like, gosh, I don't know what that is. And that's it, right? So that's pretty straightforward. So there's claims that it could be an alien spacecraft, which there's subcategories under that. It could be a three-dimensional nuts and bolts vehicle, or it could be like energy, like orbs or a morphing sort of thing. It could be something atmospheric like clouds or ball lightning. It could be aircraft, could be birds, balloons, satellites, right? It could be a straight-up hoax, or it could be secret government technology. I mean, there's – so there I'm saying you have all these categories and subcategories and subcategories. So that on the other side, aliens, well, what's that? Well, there's the claim that they're from within our solar system, or from the further reaches of space, or from alternate realities, or from a multiverse, from other dimensions within our universe. They could be spirits, such as from the angelic or demonic realm. They could be bioorganisms, right? So again, you have so many categories, like someone having experiences with aliens, it could actually be a government op. Right. And that's something very real, or a straight up hoax. So so what are these people experiencing? Well, it really depends. Maybe they, like many of these poster children kind of guys in these fields, maybe they got involved with the occult and they're having demonic experiences. Or maybe they're being manipulated by the government, which I think, for example, Whitley Strieber fits both of those categories by his own admissions. And so, like I said, that's what it's very difficult for me, because I can see how many different ways there are to look at it, and that no one answer is going to be succinct enough for be able to cover everything, because it is such a wide variety of phenomena.
Why did you say that about Strieber? And are you familiar with the story about where people say that Strieber claims that he was part of that Finders cult, or he went to that school in Mexico where they were taking those Finders children?
Okay, so one thing I'll say about Strieber is, you know, you have people like Travis Walton, right? If you'll remember, the movie Fire in the Sky was made of his experience, right?
Sure.
Okay, Travis Walton to me is a very down-to-earth guy. He just says, hey, look, I had this one experience one time. I'm always telling the same story, and that's what it is. That, to me, that's like, okay, he's down-to-earth. On the other hand, you have people like Whitley Strieber or Billy Meyer who it's almost like they want to place themselves in the center of reality, in the center of history, where they've been there, they've done that. You know, they've time traveled, they've reincarnated, they've been to other planets, they have spiritual experiences, they've done it all, they've been everywhere, and it's almost like a messiah complex, right? Mm. So Strieber is very much like that. Exactly. He's claimed he's been to Mars. He played a key role in ancient Rome. He has reincarnated, and one of his most recent things is that he's now a necromancer, because the latest book he published, he claims that he wrote with his deceased wife after she died. Okay, she's the co-writer of his new book after she passed away. So, you know, Ed, I don't know. I've heard of ghost writing, but this is ridiculous.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of any of that.
Yeah.
You know, and Strieber's a guy that wrote a very popular book. Communion was a huge bestseller. You have to have backing. Then he co-wrote a book with Bell, too, that, you know, that again had to have a huge backing, you know.
Right. So back to the question is, well, for one, he claims that he started having these experiences, at least as he first consciously remembered them, in a meditation room in his house in New York. Mm. Okay, so there you go. He's engaged in some form of occult practice, and guess what? These beings appeared to him. And now he has never claim that they are aliens, really. Maybe every now and then he'll use that term, but it's very, very rare. He refers to them as visitors. And his guesses as to what his experiences are and what the visitors are, have obviously, he's been doing this for decades, so he's had many, many, many opinions trying to figure it all out. So that's the one side of it. The other side of it is, yeah, exactly. He has been involved in various groups, and he has claimed to have been a victim of MKUltra mind control experimentation by the CIA. Okay, that's his claim. And so he also claims that as a child he underwent these experimentations, including Skinner box treatment, where they would literally place a child inside of in a box and seal them up. So it's a form of sensory deprivation. So he is very open about these claims that he underwent mind control experimentation by the government. Okay. And now what's really, to me, what's odd is, well, then why does he also claim that he's having these experiences with otherworldly entities? And really it comes down to that he claims that the evidence that is not just mind control is that whenever he had experiences with the visitors, people who ran into him on those days would point out to him that he seemed like agitated. Okay, now that's to me very flimsy, but it goes to show that, well, wait a minute, if you just underwent a session of mind control experimentation, of course you would be agitated. That wouldn't necessarily mean that you had real experiences with actual entities from beyond. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Now, does he claim he's still getting these visitations and stuff like this up to this day?
He does. And like I said, now he has them with his own wife, too, his deceased wife.
Right, which is definitely not an alien. That's a different platform.
Right, exactly. So that's my point is he, any experience, anything that comes up, he then decides to claim, oh, I've been there, I've done that, right? And so my heart breaks for him because, for one, he loved his wife very, very, very deeply, and he's obviously extremely distraught. But, well, you know, now he claims that he's still communicating with her regularly, And he's obviously undergone mind control experimentation, and the poor guy's just...
Well, let me ask a question.
It's frustrating.
How can we be sure he's gone through mind control experimentation? How do we know he's not just making that up?
I don't think we can. Yeah. I think it's just one of the many, 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 many claims that Strieber has made about himself that it's convenient enough that nobody can really research it. Just like many other of these people, like Billy Meyer, same kind of thing. His experiences begin when he's living in an ashram in India. Mm. So again, he's engaged in whatever level of occult practices, and he starts having these supposed experiences with alleged aliens. And that's been ongoing for decades and decades and decades as well. And same with him. He claims he's traveled through time. He's been to other planets. He's the messenger of these aliens, and on it goes.
Yeah, he says with the bodyguard for the Shah of Iran, I think he said, right?
That doesn't sound familiar.
No? Okay. Maybe I haven't confused with somebody else.
I'm saying it doesn't sound familiar. Mm-hmm. I might just not be aware of it.
Might have been L. Ron Hubbard. I think they both have the same type of... And by the way, L. Ron Hubbard is another one dabbling in this kind of occult stuff and claim that the Thetan that he used to visit looked just like one of those little gray aliens as well. You know?
Well, that's the thing, too. I mean, Hubbard was involved in the occultism of Crowleyism. And then he, too, basically establishes a UFO cult by claiming that the galactic overlord Xenu bombed aliens on Earth in volcanoes. And now these became spirit beings that then attached to us. And then we have all these psychological problems that only Scientology can rid us of.
For a price. For a price. Don't forget that. Yeah. We gotta pay those bills.
Well, see, first it was Dianetics, but then when he was facing lawsuits for making medical claims, it all of a sudden became the Church of Scientology.
Hmm. Well, you mentioned a lot that there's an occult influence in this, right? What is your faith? What is your beliefs?
I'm a Messianic Jew, call me a Christian. I don't mind either term. Hmm. And that's something I came to relatively late in life when I was 27. After, as you can tell, after having exposed myself to a great number of different ideas, concepts, philosophies, and even oddities, like I said, from the age of 11, being into reading about witchcraft, the cryptozoology, and UFOs and aliens.
And how old are you now today?
I just turned 49.
49. Still a young man. First. It gets worse, man. I'm 57. It gets worse.
Each year, right here.
It gets harder and harder, man. 49 is like one of the last good years, man.
Oh, okay. I'll enjoy it.
Now, what about occult? Did you ever dabble in the occult during your explorations of your life?
You know, I think that in a way the Lord really protected me because as interested as I was in a lot of weird stuff. And for instance, I had a girlfriend whose family was big, big time into the New Age. So I had some interest in that already. I had some interest in that. But of all the stuff I had an interest in, I didn't really dive into anything that much. I just kind of would learn about it and maybe touch upon it a little bit, but I never really dove in head first to any of it. And I think that was ultimately good because it protected me from getting involved in a lot of really weird stuff.
We have a lot of parallel experiences. I also explored all these different things, and I brought up as a Catholic, you know, but I examined different New Age stuff, and I had a girlfriend into the tarot cards and all kind of stuff. But I never delved over into the evil. I always knew good from evil. I never stepped over that. Then I got saved at, I think it was 29 years old, and I'm born again Christian, Pentecostal Christian. And that's when I started reading the Bible. And by the way, too, I was all influenced by all that Eric Von Daniken stuff. I love that stuff, man. When I was a kid in the 70s, man, 79, you know, that was the bomb, man. You know, get those books because they didn't have it on TV every 5 minutes. You really had to go look for it. But when I first started reading the Bible, I started studying the Bible, I did look at it from a perspective of, hey, let me see if I can see any alien stuff in here. Now, what about yourself, and what did you find?
Well, I do have a whole chapter about whether there's any of that in the Bible, and sorry, but no.
Then what about angels? You know, the idea. Did you ever read the Bible with the idea that perhaps these angels were coming from, I don't know, from UFOs, from flying saucers or something like that, or dimensional, time-dimensional type of things?
Okay, so this is where we go back to the issue of defining terms and categorization, because, okay, if you want to call angels extraterrestrials, then, yeah, that fits, because they are not from this Earth. Hmm. So there you go. Does that mean that they were born on another planet biologically and then developed the high tech to build the craft that could get them here? No, that doesn't mean that. So, again, it's kind of difficult to discuss these issues without having to stop at every single turn and define our terms and, well, what exactly do we mean? So what I found in researching the Bible for this particular book is that anything that had been claimed to be some kind of alien or UFO wasn't. But yeah, of course you have entities from other realms or dimensions or whatever you want to call them, like, you know, angels, demons, various spirits. Yeah, you do have that. Cherubim, seraphim, you definitely have that.
And what about people who think that the Anunnaki, who describe that the Nephilim were actually the Anunnaki?
Yeah, I'm aware of that. Yeah. And I find that there's usually a huge difference between what is popularly claimed versus what the primary source documentation actually states. Hmm. Right? So the issue of Nephilim is very straightforward in the Bible. I mean, they are born here on Earth. They didn't come here from anywhere else. Hmm. So that's one issue right there. But again, I think that the question of whether aliens are actually biological entities that were born on another planet, I think that that should be our last the last thing that we actually consider seriously, not because it's not serious on its face, but because there's so many other options that that phenomena could be, that are more mundane, that are more accessible, that are more obvious, that we should look at those first. Like I said, like government experimentation, like hoaxes, the occult experiences. Those, I think, should always come first because they're a lot more obvious and readily available to us to look at and think about. Think of Strieber again. I always go back to him because he's just a plethora of examples, right? So he says one day a visitor appeared to him, and knowing that he was very disturbed by the way that their eyes look, he says, oh, okay, you know, watch this. And he put the visitor put on a ridiculous large pair of sunglasses to kind of make a joke to him about how, oh, look, we'll hide our eyes from you if it's going to be a big deal, you know, because he went from being terrorized by these beings to just kind of being pals, you know. Anyhow, so I'm thinking, well, so what is the more likely explanation? What is the Occam's razor suggestion here, that he's actually having experience with paranormal beings that are going to make him feel a little better by putting on sunglasses, or that he's being experimented upon by somebody in the government who does put on these ridiculously large sunglasses, and he's in such a state of hypersuggestibility that he ends up being told, hey, we're visitors, and he believes it. Hmm. See what I mean?
And is that your conclusion? It seems to be like your conclusion is that, first of all, these people are dabbling in the occult, so they're open to evil forces and manipulation and mind control. But also, too, that there seems to be a government involvement, or it doesn't even have to be government, too. Maybe there's other entities out there, big companies and big businesses and other interests, you know, that are out there to manipulate us as well. So is that what you think is going on?
If I had to make my two best guesses, yeah, it would be those two, and that they might combine at a certain point. So, for instance, back in the 90s, Martin Cannon wrote a book called The Controllers.
Right.
And there he explained that by what was then the high-tech devices, one could easily explain just about every single alien and UFO experience. And I mean, like I said, that was the 90s. I would love for somebody to write an update to that book, employing our modern technology, which is so vastly advanced from that. But he made it very, very clear that from things even as simple as what's known as voice-to-skull technology,
right.
it means that I could be speaking to you from across the room and the person next to you wouldn't hear me. So you're literally hearing voices in your head that the person standing next to you wouldn't hear. And that's just like very simplistic technology that has been around for a while, much less what could be done through implants. And so that was in the 90s. He made that abundantly clear. So to me, and on the other side of it, besides just people dabbling in the occult, one of my conclusions came about from the messages that are being given to us by these aliens.
Okay,
so now for one, we have decades and decades worth of supposed messages from aliens. And once you cut through all the fluff and puff, and there's a tremendous amount of fluff and puff, mostly because a lot of it is stated in new agey type terms, which is all fluffy and puffy. But I noticed that inevitably they tell us three things. Okay, and they're stated to us in the perfect example of disinformation, which is the three things they claim are true, but the problem is their solution. Okay, so the three main things they inevitably tell us are, one, you humans are always battling each other over politics, governments, nations, wars. Okay, yeah, of course, granted, definitely. You humans are constantly battling each other over theology, right, or religions. Okay, yeah, absolutely, granted. You humans are destroying the earth. You're polluting the planet. Okay, yeah, definitely, granted. Okay, so there you go. That's the three things they tell us, and they're all true. But then what's their solution? Well, you got to form a one-world government with a one-world religion, and you need to worship the earth as a goddess. Okay, so then I think, well, wait a minute. Why is it that aliens are traveling from the far distances of space or from other dimensions to get involved in our politics and theology? And why is their ultimate solution the exact same solution, the same goal, rather, than that of the Antichrist in the book of Revelation? Well, why is that?
And what did you conclude?
Well, that's my point. It's a rhetorical question. Is why would they tell us that the ultimate solution is the same solution as the Antichrist in Revelation? One world government, one world religion, and as per Romans chapter 1, to worship the earth, to worship creation instead of the creator.
And on the other hand, they have to take that out of our education. They have to prevent us from understanding the book of Revelation and the story of the Bible.
Well, so that's one of my bottom line issues, is why would they tell us that the ultimate solution is to take on the goals of the Antichrist?
Right.
So, yeah, what do we have in our schools today, Ed? We have essentially earth worship disguised as concerns over whatever climate change might mean. Over Earth Day, over making sure that every subject is taught without a single reference to God, over how, you name it, we need to start looking to populate other planets because we're becoming unsustainable in terms of population levels and pollution. We need to move to other planets where we might run into aliens. You know, all that stuff is brewing.
Yeah, I always wondered too, like, if we can go to the moon or Mars and create an atmosphere over there that's sustainable, what, because we have to leave our planet, why couldn't we just do that here? You know what I mean? Why can't we just, why do we have to travel over there and start creating an atmosphere? Create it over here. Listen, let me take a commercial break real quick. Okay?
Sure.
We're with Ken Ammi, and the book is called 50 Shades of Grey Aliens. In consideration of aliens, UFOs, abductees, contactees, experiencers, channeling, and more. And you can find his website at truefreethinker.com. We'll be right back with more of Ken Ammi right after these messages. And now a word from our sponsors. AlmightyGold.com. Get your gold in affordable quantities. 1 gram, 2.5 grams, 5 grams, no minimum purchase required. Why save in paper when you can save in gold? AlmightyGold.com understands it's difficult to afford gold in large quantities. No one can afford an ounce of gold. This is why Almighty Gold has introduced to you Carat Bars, a most reliable company where you can buy gold in minor quantities from as little as a tenth of a gram. That's like $6. Each gold bar is inset into the Carat Bar frame, which is a standard credit card size, and it's covered by a safety laminate. It's imprinted with a unique DNA for counterfeit protection and provided with a black light authenticity signature on the front. Gold, AlmightyGold.com. They have a cryptocurrency backed in gold, and you can become an affiliate at AlmightyGold.com and make a commission from any gold that is purchased from your affiliate link. It's contact us at AlmightyGold.com. That's their email address. Contact us at AlmightyGold.com. Gold! Have you ever thought about opening your own mobile cart or kiosk business? Maybe add new point-of-sale locations across the country quickly, or bring in revenue by adding coffee, food, or retail services to your office building, warehouse, or lobby? CartKing.com is the answer to your needs. CartKing.com is a North American designer and manufacturer of the finest mobile retail, coffee, food, carts, and kiosks that money can buy. For 20 years, CartKing.com has been working with clients across America to provide indoor and outdoor carts and kiosks for any application. That's www.cart-king.com. Give them a call at 877-986-7771. Tell them Ed Opperman sent you. So you go to the website, cartking.com. You check out their different designs and models. You pick out which design applies to your business. They'll custom design it for you, custom build it for you, and ship it worldwide. cartking.com. PureSoapFlakes.com. 218-568-2525. Have you ever heard of Castile Soap? Pure Soap Flake Company handcrafts fine soap bars, laundry powder, and concentrated soap flakes using organic vegetable oils from their northern Minnesota facility. Bathe your body and wash your clothes with Pure Soap products that are free of fragrance, GMOs, palm oil, sodium lauryl sulfate, and synthetic additives. Keep it clean, folks. Pure Soap Flake Company products are kind to living creatures and sensitive skin, safe for drains and waterways, and work great in high-efficiency washers and top and front-loading machines. Order today at PureSoapFlakes.com, Greenhome.com, Amazon.com, or give them a call, 218-568-2525, 218-568-2525. Pure Soap Flake Company is a proud member of the Handcrafted Soap and Cosmetic Guild.
It's the Opperman Report. And now, here is investigator Ed Opperman.
Okay, welcome back to the Opperman Report. I'm your host, private investigator Ed Opperman. We're with Ken Ammi. The book is 50 Shades of Grey Aliens, in consideration of aliens, UFOs, abductees, contactees, experiencers, and channelers. And his website is truefreethinker.com. Okay, we seem to be on the same page here. You know, you got people dabbling in the occult, and then you got the government, you know, which is pretty much not on our side. And then you got characters like Rupert Murdoch. He's not doing us any favors. Okay, this guy's not out to educate or help you or me. But now, what about all these people who were just your average guy, and they wound up, you know, now they think they're an experiencer. They got, you know, they're frequent guests on these shows. Like not like guys like Strieber, who actually has a background in this kind of stuff, but these other characters who believe they're talking to aliens, are they hoaxing? Are they deluded? What's going on with these characters?
Well, that's part of the problem in this phenomena, is it's so very hard to tell. Unless you know a certain amount of information about their personal life or their circumstances at the time, it's almost impossible to tell. I mean, I'll give you an example. You know the Dr. Phil show?
Sure.
He recently had a guest on who claimed to be a victim of targeted attacks by some kind of government entity where she's being made to hear voices and all this stuff, okay? And then she says that all of a sudden she started seeing unusual alien-like beings in her house. So after hearing her out for a while, he points out that, well, weren't you also shooting up heroin? So, yeah, she was. Oh, okay, so now that makes it really difficult because this kind of electronic interference is a real thing, and some people have been targeted. We even get it in the mainstream media every now and then when we hear that one of our embassies in another country has obviously been targeted by microwaves or whatever. But then, you know, you throw in this thing about, well, okay, but you were also shooting up heroin in this case. Okay, well, then that kind of throws a gigantic wrench into figuring out what really happened, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So you have, like I said, you have Travis Walton, for example, like I said, very down to earth. He claims he one time had one experience. He's always told the same story. He's taken multiple polygraphs, and he always passes. But the polygraph doesn't determine truth. It just determines that he actually believes it. So again, what did he experience? I certainly don't know.
Yeah, we do know he was missing for a few days. That's pretty much been confirmed. He was out of touch there. You know, it's interesting because you were talking about how this woman on Dr. Phil and stuff. We go through these phases, you know, of like back in the late 90s, everyone thought they were being abducted. You saw it on TV constantly. And now we seem to have this this group of people who call themselves targeted individuals.
Exactly.
Right. Okay. Now, did you look into
that? That's what she was talking about. Yes.
Yeah. Now, right. Now, all of a sudden, now everyone thinks they're targeted individuals. You know, like, did you look into that and apply that to your theories here?
That specific phenomena under that specific term didn't really come into my awareness until after the book, but that's exactly what this particular woman was talking about. And it is a real phenomena. It does happen to some people, but then when you start bringing in other points of consideration, it's so hard to tell why it's being done, if that is what is being done, in fact. So that's what I'm saying. Everything is so slippery that it gets really frustrating to attempt to pinpoint anything.
Do you think it's possible that even with all this manipulation and occult influence and purpose disinfo, that we have been visited from foreign planets and galaxies and universes?
I mean, again, to me, that's like the last thing to consider. I mean, there's so much more that's much more realistic and accessible that, well, okay, if that happens, then so be it. But that, to me, that's way, way down the line. And again, if these beings actually show up and we can actually verify that they come from another planet, again, why are you coming here to get involved in our politics and theology? Why do you sound exactly like the Book of Revelation in Romans chapter 1? Why? But actually, keeping going on this point about the occultism, as you read the subtitle of the book, I wanted to mention channeling for a second, because to me that is incredibly convenient how so many people claim to be channeling aliens, such as Barbara Marciniak. You know, Barbara Marciniak had been channeling supposed aliens for a dozen years when she was on Coast to Coast, and she was asked, who are they? And she said, I don't know. I'm like, well, wait a minute. You're relating to us messages from supposed aliens from the Pleiades for a dozen years, and when you're asked who they are, you got to admit that you don't know? I mean, that should be like one of the first things you try to figure it out. Not to mention, incidentally, that according to Billy Meyer, anybody who claims to be in contact with aliens from the Pleiades is instantly identifying themselves as a bunk artist, you know, as a hoaxer.
And why is that?
Well, but this actually includes Meyer himself, because early on he himself claimed that the aliens he was in touch with were from the Pleiades. But then they decided to tell him, well, we're not really from the Pleiades. We're not Pleiadians. We're actually Plejarans. See, one thing that happens is early on in the contactee movement, oh, the aliens are from Mars or they're from Pluto. You know, they're from just somewhere in our solar system. But as time progressed and we explore our solar system, oh, guess what? Really, we're not from your solar system. We're from beyond. You know, we're from Alpha Centauri. We're from the Pleiadian, the Pleiades. Well, then we recognize that it's very unlikely that any biological organism could live there. And now, well, guess what? Actually, we're from the farthest reaches of your universe. We're from another universe altogether, from another dimension. And so they kind of keep moving further and further away the more and more we learn. And so that's what's funny about the Meyer case is, as often happens with him, he'll make a claim, and when he's called on it, he changes his mind. Or rather, he claims that the aliens gave him new information. But so that's what's really funny is if they want to fight it out, let them, because she claims they're Pleiadians. He claims that that means that she's a hoaxer, and so, well, you know, let them deal with it within themselves, right?
Is Meyer still alive today?
I believe he is, and he's been at this since at least the 70s.
Yeah.
But again, the issue of channeling is fascinating because as a channeler of aliens, you don't have to have had any experience with aliens. You don't have to have had observed a UFO. You don't have to have anything except just to hear these voices. And so in my mind, it's like, well, wait a minute. How come channelers of supposed aliens and channelers of supposed deceased humans, how come they have the same shtick? Mm. How come they sound exactly the same and they do exactly the same things?
Let me ask you this. There's a show I listen to for entertainment every now and then. Dr. Sam Muggsy and Drake and these characters, right? And what's it called? The Quantum something, right? And you know, they actually claim that during the commercial breaks they've left and gotten into a UFO and traveled around and done things, you know. And then they come out there channeling and they have all this information and stuff like that. And it's just so wild. The content that they're presenting is just so wild and so ridiculous. But these groups have a big, big audience, okay? When you read the comments on their YouTube channel, there are people out there that believe this. Okay, man? And it is like, so, man, what do you make of that? How is that possible?
Well, yeah, let me say, I'm not laughing at those people. I'm just laughing at the fact that yes, I mean, sometimes with everything I do online, I definitely get into the most discussions on YouTube.
Yeah.
And it is shocking sometimes that you either watch a video on YouTube or you read comments and you go, wow, the internet is an amazing place. I mean, I'm watching these people's pathologies laid out right before me. I mean, it's truly incredible. And so part of it is sort of a replacement of the true theology, right, which is desperately seeking for something supernatural or paranormal or outlandish or different to give somebody's daily life some kind of monicum of meaning, and therefore reaching in any possible direction to grasp whatever we can to say that there's something beyond me, there's something greater than myself. And if you don't want to think that that's the one true living God, then you're going to basically replace that with anything. Mm. Like I said, Romans 1 talks about how people will worship the creature rather than the creator.
And it's interesting because just like people would go to church, you know, every Sunday, and these guys wait for Thursday night or Friday night for their favorite YouTube channel to pop up and give them that same kind of a replacement.
You know, that's right. In fact, one of the chapters I have, I titled it Ancient Atheist Aliens, because I noticed in the atheist movement, they're doing the same thing. They're somewhat admitting that they can recognize the universe is fine-tuned, as much as they hate to admit that. But hey, it was aliens. Or how did human life came to be? Well, it was aliens. And who's going to really get us out of this political and environmental jam? It's aliens. So in other words, the atheist thing, they're looking to aliens as our universal saviors. Same thing.
Ken, I can't thank you enough. This is excellent content you're sharing here with people. The book is called 50 Shades of Gray Aliens, and the website is called thetruefreethinker.com. Before we go, what do you want to leave us with?
Well, I want to leave you with, I appreciate you having me on. I appreciate your audience. Like I said, I've been a longtime fan. And if anything, I apologize that it's so difficult to even discuss this phenomena, because it is not this phenomena. It is these phenomena. There's so much involved, and it's so complex and multi-layered that it really is difficult for me to... Okay, let me put it this way instead. It'd be really easy for me to get on here and spout off a lot of silver bullets and pretend like I got it all figured out, and that would get me a lot of attention. But sorry, that's just not the reality of the matter. So that's why I'm, in a lot of ways, I'm having to say I don't know, and let's consider five different things and see which one might be true, because it is truly a difficult topic. So that's really what the book is about, is presenting these phenomena from various points of view.
No, I hear you. And the more you're looking into these things and you meet these different people, like you said, like we're talking up there, you start meeting these people. You know, it's just like you have more questions than answers. You know, as time goes on, it's just because there's so much disinformation out there and charlatans and hucksters.
Yes.
And like you said, that spiritual element, that demonic element that's out there captures people.
Indeed.
Ken Ammi, thank you so much. If you had anything else you want to come back, let me know.
Appreciate it, Ed.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. God bless.
God bless you. So then we had Ken Ammi. Like I said, the book is called 50 Shades of Grey Aliens. In consideration of aliens, UFOs, abductees, contactees, experiences, channeling, and more. And I think he's onto some good stuff there. I can definitely relate to what he says. There's a lot in common there, too. As you know, too, I had the girlfriend who was a Messianic Jew who I was very good friends with, the Jews for Jesus. If you'll enjoy today's show, this is probably going in the member section, but if you enjoyed today's show, check out our member section, OppermanReport.com. We can always use a donation, too. I'll give you 13 months for $65. A lot of great new content coming in. And just taped a couple hours with the guys from Knock Down the House, that great new documentary. It's winning awards all over the place. Got some new content going up there. Donations, always looking for donations. Victoria's trying to get into college. We have a GoFundMe going up right now. Help Victoria get into college. You can find that on my Facebook or YouTube, on the website. And thank you so much, Ken Ammi. And now a word from our sponsors. AlmightyGold.com. Get your gold in affordable quantities. 1 gram, 2.5 grams, 5 grams, no minimum purchase required. Why save in paper when you can save in gold? AlmightyGold.com understands it's difficult to afford gold in large quantities. No one can afford an ounce of gold. This is why Almighty Gold has introduced to you Carat Bars, a most reliable company where you can buy gold in minor quantities from as little as a tenth of a gram. That's like $6. Each gold bar is inset into the Carat Bar frame, which is a standard credit card size, and it's covered by a safety laminate. It's imprinted with a unique DNA for counterfeit protection and provided with a black light authenticity signature on the front. Gold, AlmightyGold.com. They have a cryptocurrency backed in gold, and you can become an affiliate at AlmightyGold.com and make a commission from any gold that is purchased from your affiliate link. It's contact us at AlmightyGold.com. That's their email address. Contact us at AlmightyGold.com. Gold! Have you ever thought about opening your own mobile cart or kiosk business? Maybe add new point-of-sale locations across the country quickly, or bring in revenue by adding coffee, food, or retail services to your office building, warehouse, or lobby? CartKing.com is the answer to your needs. CartKing.com is a North American designer and manufacturer of the finest mobile retail, coffee, food, carts, and kiosks that money can buy. For 20 years, CartKing.com has been working with clients across America to provide indoor and outdoor carts and kiosks for any application. That's www.cart-king.com. Give them a call at 877-986-7771. Tell them Ed Opperman sent you. So you go to the website, cartking.com. You check out their different designs and models. You pick out which design applies to your business. They'll custom design it for you, custom build it for you, and ship it worldwide. Cartking.com. PureSoapFlakes.com. 218-568-2525. Have you ever heard of Castile Soap? Pure Soap Flake Company handcrafts fine soap bars, laundry powder, and concentrated soap flakes using organic vegetable oils from their northern Minnesota facility. Bathe